This part of this morning's session, the speaker is Professor Yuri Kivshar from Australian National University. Professor Kivshar has been a very active and visible player in this field, so it is my pleasure to give the floor to him for him to begin his lecture.
Thank you very much. Good morning, everyone. First of all, I'm very glad that I'm here and so many young people from China sitting there. And I thank John and City Chan for inviting me. So I think it's kind of an interesting story because I was talking to one of the Chinese professors here and said, somehow a few years ago, Chinese students were not interested in Australia because somehow this country did not exist from scientific level. So. But after my good friend Brian Schmidt got Nobel Prize last year, he's from Australian National University, and also after high ranking for ANU, our university, I think somehow Chinese students got interested in Australia. Particularly in my group, we have four Chinese students who came from different, being supported by different sources. And at least two of them are absolutely excellent. And we sent one to Imperial, and actually John may confirm that something happens now, so Australia is in a, back to the scientific world. You may see that I have two addresses associated with my name. So first, it's a nonlinear physics center, which I created in 2000 at Australian National University. It's a center with a variety of interests. And this part of research is also supported by CUDAS, which we established with Ben Eggleton and Ross and other people about 10 years ago. Now we have a third wave of CUDAS, and now nanoplasmonics and metamaterials are formally supported, at least some of the activities, by new CUDAS. And the second address is St. Petersburg University of Information Technology. This is related to so-called mega grant program, which the Russian government established 3 years ago. Actually, I got one of the first grants, and this is the third year. So basically, I established group there based on the former small group of Pavel Belov. So two addresses you may check. I do not list all people. This will take few transparencies, three or more, many, many people, so about 30 people in Canberra, and about 40 people in St. Petersburg, different level, different support. But so you may check if you are interested in our groups and activities. So what I try to do, because this conference about plasmonics and metamaterials, I try to highlight some of the recent activities we are doing, because many of you are not aware of what we are doing last year, because the developments are so rapid. But I selected, in according to the topics of this meeting, some topics on plasmonics, in particular nonlinear part in each of the topics, and then a bit of metamaterials. David made a good job for me to introduce nonlinearities. And then talking about some of our work, also we'll discuss more recent developments, which I didn't hear so far here. about all the electric metamaterials, all the electric antennas. And of course, I should absolutely sure mention funnel resonances. This is kind of my toy, which I enjoy for many years, and particular even before people started to discuss it widely in plasmonics. And because it was name of circuitry mentioned yesterday, I put it in a bit different context. So this is what CUDAS wants from us. CUDAS, it's Ben Eggleton, signal processing, nonlinear optics for signal processing. They want from us metamaterial circuitry. So that's what I didn't hear yet, but I will mention how we go into that direction. First of all, it's an interesting topic of IRI beams. So IRI beams were around for a number of years. Somehow we're not noticed by metamaterial and plasmonic communities. And this is because this is, of course, entirely linear objects. But IRI beams can be linked to rapid developments of plasmonic circuitry. I will not give any introduction to plasmons. We have top experts sitting in the audience. So I just will mention that usually when people talk about plasmonic circuitry, we assume kind of waveguides, which are created on surface along which surface plasmon polariton propagates. And this concept which was developed by many groups, and this nice overview in Nature Photonics. But the question is if we can do something beyond that, if you can do some plasmonic optics without any waveguides and lenses. And in normal optics and usual optics, classical optics, we know this very well because we know that in the air, of course, we can propagate, and similar to waveguides, we can propagate beams, which is so-called non-diffracting beams. This was several interesting active topic. In optics, people generate different types of non-diffracting beams. The most familiar is Bessel beams, but there are other ones. So IRE beams actually belong to this family, but it actually two-dimensional IRE beams are composed of two 1D IRE beams, so simple beams. So its names comes from IRE, who actually introduced this function, which is presented in an integral form. But somehow it was brought to attention to physicists by Michael Berry. Michael Berry is everywhere, like John Pendry. And we basically should acknowledge his input to American Journal of Physics, when basically he demonstrated that if you take a Schrodinger equation, you can look at different type of solution, the Schrodinger equation, and you find very interesting solution, which is described by IRE function. This is formally solutions which is unbounded, so it carries infinite energy, so it looks useless at the first instance, but then due to efforts of groups of Christodoulidis, basically it was shown that we don't need that infinite functions. We may cut it and then look at the properties, which are properties very remarkable, in particular because of that highly asymmetric form, these beams which propagate being bended, so they're non-diffracting. So basically this is some spreading due to cutting of the extensions. So the only representative of so-called one-dimensional non-diffracting beams, and that we are accelerating along this curved parabolic trajectories. So people generated in different settings IRE beams, and we wanted to actually, when we got access to some fabrications, we thought what we should do first to generate IRE beams in the laboratory. Amazingly, somehow not only us, but several other groups wanted to do that. And again, that's example, that's why I selected it, to show that the powerful development of Chinese science. So you see that Xian Zhang in the US and Berkeley, and then a group of Professor Zhu, here, so basically four groups simultaneously generated IRE plasmons in different settings, and somehow PRL like us more, and we generated plasmon beams, so basically as non-diffracting beams on the chip. For that, of course, in order to generate beam-specific shape, we need to shape phase of that beam. So we created a specially designed phase mask and actually couple light to specific mode, which correspond close to this IRE beam, and so actually propagation of this interesting curved beams on the surface. And then detected it by SNOM. So what is interesting, of course, if you look at the generated beams, this is a superposition of light emitted by different holes with a specific sequences, and we resemble very much what we simulated directly. Of course, we may play different games. We can actually put defects, so observe. So we did it. So basically, observing so-called self-healing effect, when basically beam reproduce itself. And what is important is that normal plasmons on the surface will propagate three times shorter. So basically, these beams really demonstrate a longer propagation distance in spite of diffraction because of their structure. So we can play in different games, particular to notice that if you get a taper of this metal dielectric waveguide and put the plasmon beams inside of that waveguide with a taper, taper will act like an effective linear potential, and this linear potential will interact with a beam and may even curve it back. create a straight beam propagating along the surface, and even curved back. So it's a lot of interesting games you may play with these creatures. So very recently, we look at the interactions of the IR beam in collaboration, this work in collaboration with Jena group. I forgot to mention that at that time we didn't have SNOM. and recently, we look at the interaction of this beam, so creating of hot spots due to collisions of two IR beams generated by two different masks. And these collisions, of course, happening at much longer distances for single plasmon. And this hotspot can be controlled. And to our great surprise, it was mentioned as one of the 10 most downloaded papers in August from Optics Letter. So we should expect many more papers on IR beams. Of course, most of my life, I was working with nonlinear effects, nonlinear optics. And when we moved to a new field of plasmonics, we wanted to see many nonlinear effects there. But it turns out the story is much more complicated. First of all, how to introduce nonlinearities? Usually, the simplest way, because we have a plasmons as a collective modes excited at the surface between dielectric and metal, we may think that the simplest way, of course, to introduce nonlinearities into dielectric, similar to what people do with waveguides. And that's what actually was done by many people. And there is a really history which starts from 86, when people introduce nonlinearities in dielectric and see what happens with the plasmons, the collective modes of field electrons excited at the surface. And one of the, of course, we may look at different type of effects, but self-action effect is known to produce so-called solitons. We were termed plasmon solitons. And the first temporal solitons were studied in crude approximation by Alan Borman. And then later on, people look at spatial solitons. So you may view it that like a mode which is sitting in a slot. Here, that's a study of spatial solitons, and it's localized due to nonlinearities in a slot which is composed of nonlinear dielectric. So this should be kind of localized mode which resembles spatial solitons studied in nonlinear optics and waveguides in many different type of media. However, the story is not that simple because we have strong losses in metals in our system. So what does it mean? Usually solitons viewed like a balance between nonlinearity and diffraction. So if you can manage shape of the beam in such a way that we can balance diffraction, that we get a soliton propagating like a spatial solitons. Here we have strong dissipations, and you can't be dissipation at all because dissipation and losses is the strongest effect. Recently, in collaboration with the Imperial College, with Otwin Hess group, we applied the very powerful machinery of FDD simulations to look what happens with pulses which propagate as the interface between nonlinear medium, nonlinear dielectric, and metal. And you see what basically happening. And this is the destiny of all types of the simple plasmon pulses propagating in metal dielectric waveguide. So usually, when you don't have nonlinearity, you see that this is the width of the pulse. You see that basically it's growing all the time, so pulse spreading. So it's very typical effect in optical fibers. If you include nonlinearity, it balances diffraction or dispersion here because it pulses, and then it should create soliton. What does it mean? Soliton means that we should create a pulse with a constant width. So basically, this will correspond to soliton. But here, you see focusing. So focusing still can be observed. But then eventually, this curves went up because dissipation is the strongest effect. So basically, losses kills everything. So but still, we can observe kind of self-focusing effect. So it can be visible experiment. And we now know that it should be even better if you play with parameters. What interesting is that you may compare basically slot waveguides and plasmon on a single surface and see that plasmon surface propagates much, much longer. What is the way to actually beat that? Because basically the whole concept of solitons would not work in the presence of strong dissipation. So one of the ways is to use what people actually suggested long time ago like Max Stockman and other people to make a taper. If you look at the slot waveguide and make a taper, then taper would allow you to shape the beam in vertical directions when we have a slot, and then taper will help somehow to compensate for dissipation. This is known from fiber optics when we use tapered fibers to compensate for losses. And here it works very well. Of course, we can't increase power because we don't have gain in the system, but we can compensate for amplitude decay. So basically, if you don't have taper, so usually you have diffraction. When you introduce taper, we can create a soliton. Beam will keep amplitude unchanged. Of course, we can make a stronger taper. We can even focus beam, so it go to what people call nano-focusing. This is a nice property which may help to design some devices, and we spent some efforts to play with this property and demonstrate it recently that how it may work. So for people who like equations, I just put effective Schrodinger equations for amplitude, which shows we get exactly tapering enter this equation. This is gamma is losses. So you see the tapering, so not vanishing derivative here may actually interplay with dissipations and get amplitude stable for soliton propagation. So we may look at different type of devices, and we try to actually make realistic estimation for so-called coupler. So nonlinear coupler is one of the traditional devices in integrated optics, in nonlinear integrated optics. And here, for plasmonics, of course, coupler is not functional because of losses. However, if we make both arms of this coupler tapered, so we can actually achieve a switching from one arm to another one, or at least efficiently increase the power which goes from one arm to another one, these curves show that basically this is no tapers. When at taper, we can see much high amount of power going to the second arm, almost corresponding to efficiency of normal optical coupler. So of course this should be verified in experiment. Now the other type of nonlinearities which people explore in plasmonics, David mentioned about this and describe, we expect them much stronger, but not much known about them because we depend on pulses, so it depends on many factors, even on size of the particles. But what we want to do, we want to study different type of nonlinear effects which can be expected in the system. So the model we considered recently, it's a chain of metal particles with metal nonlinearities, which we don't know well, but we take from couple of reliable publications. And then we write equations for two components of polarization of these particles. And this equation quite complicated because we take into account non-locality. This is a different non-locality. It's non-locality in interactions because it's kind of dipole models, and dipoles are long-range type of object, which long-range coupling. So that's a quite sophisticated sums, which I did not put explicitly. So basically, this long-range interactions or non-locality in interactions, two polarizations, non-linearity comes through usual terms in polarization. So, but the important thing here, in comparison with what I discussed before, is a driving force. So this is the second option to get nonlinear effects in plasmonic, to drive them by external field. This is the amplitude of driving force. So what we can see in this system, this is very interesting system with nonlinear effects. And in fact, this is very rich system, and I really expect some experimental verifications from different groups who may approach this problem experimentally, because we know that the response of metal particles, nonlinear response, may be quite large. It's a variety of different scenarios. The simplest one, which very easy to study in any nonlinear system, is to look at modulation stability. So basically, modulation stability means that you start from the system, you start driving it homogeneously. Then you increase power, you don't do anything, you just increase power, and it's still homogeneous, and the state is known to be unstable in a linear sense. Basically, as soon as you see some instabilities, That's a manifestation of strong nonlinear interaction in systems. It's a relatively simple experiment. So what happening there? You see, so depending on the amplitude and driving force, this is mismatch of frequencies. So basically, this we have a variety of scenarios. It's a so rich system, we even did not expect to find so many different interesting effects which are known in nonlinear physics. And that seems a relatively simple system. We see bistability, we see the development of modulations, breaking of modulations, with creating of some interesting creatures, which I call here oscillon. So I will explain it very briefly. So this is a gain of instability as a function of Mach number. So this is a very rich system. Why I call it oscillons? Oscillons are interesting creatures which somehow people missed in plasmonics at all. Actually, we did not enter many fields. And in optics, somehow it was no system similar to that in normal optics, even for dissipative systems. But oscillons known since 96 by Harry Sweeney, who actually took a sand and tried to shake it. When you shake it with low amplitude, nothing happens. But if you start shaking it, I think Chinese will go to check it because it's easy to check. It's students are very curious. My students, some of them try to do it. So we see that, of course, you need the special equipment to see that. So some of the parts of the sand are just jumping up and down, and the amplitude is very high. So this is kind of modulation stability. So homogeneous surface, it becomes unstable, and we create nonlinear modes which are oscillating. And this is a reproduction of kind of oscillons on the surface of viscous liquid. So it's a similar creature. So basically, we need driving, and these are not solitons. Why it's not solitons? By soliton, I would mean that if you surface will become unstable, these humps will oscillate with the same frequency, like frequency of driving force. No, here it's completely different frequency. So frequency of oscillations of this guys, it depends on linearities. And it's different from driving frequencies. That's the beauty of that. So you may see different scenarios. So this is formation of arrays of these oscillons. And I have a few simulations which show different type of scenarios. So one, when you drive homogeneously again, it breaks down, so create a pattern, so array. This is similar to in fibers. This is what they call solitons. It's still there is driving, but it's in the reference frame which is periodic. And this is something different. So even that reference frame, instability develops, and then some guys which oscillate with completely different frequency appears. That's what we call oscillons. The similar one, but you should take into account the driving background. There are a variety of different effects. I mean, it's collections of all monsters which we know in nonlinear physics in this simple model. So this is bright solitons, basically oscillons, solitons approach there. Solitons do not oscillate in that reference frame, but this oscillate, you don't see it well. But this is dark solitons, you know, like a frozen by dark. And then what we call drifting dark creatures. So this is localized mode, which is oscillating but can drift. Of course, the system has kinks because the system has bistability. We can connect two different states with localized states and collide them. So it's a lot of different things. So I'm really looking for people who may try to apply to relatively large fields to the system of metallic particles and look at this is model. Model is very rich in nonlinear effects and should be very interesting. Now I move to topic of metamaterials, and of course I should discuss nonlinear metamaterials and some tunability, but I'd like to mention first that somehow when people talk about metamaterials, they forget some of the basics which John Pendry taught us a long time ago. First of all, we have, of course, electric atom, but we need magnetic atom, and that's the most important components of metamaterials. Then, of course, metamaterials, how we understand it, is not plasmonic metamaterial. It's a metamaterial in the classical sense. This is a combination of magnetic and electric atoms. As Martin Wegener liked to say, so we put a field on two legs, something like that. So basically, we take into account both properties, electric and magnetic properties of metamaterials. Then we go to longer wavelength. This is all classic, so we look at waves propagating in such structure in artificial materials, look at different effects, including negative refraction, and study different manifestations, including perfect absorbers, which David already mentioned. But important message is that we have here two independent channels for control of linear properties, electric and magnetic. In some sense, this is a repetition what you heard from David, but I should say you because I moved to the next slide, which is less trivial. Now, what usually people do in nonlinear optics, we expand P as a function of E through, and this chi1, chi2, actually the well-known functions in optics. But here we have opportunity to actually work with magnetic response because metamaterials basically have electric and magnetic response. And one of the idea was suggested long time ago by our group, just to put these varactor diodes to make capacitance nonlinear, and it was realized. But the main message here is that we should not forget that we have two channels again. In nonlinearities, we can actually control both linear and nonlinear response from both sides, from electric side and magnetic side. This is what we don't have in plasmonics because plasmonics have only usually magnetic electric responses. So the simplest way to put varactor diodes, this is an interesting concept, which was first realized by my former student Ilya Shadrivov, and then look at different effects and tuning of metamaterials through change of nonlinear resonance. But one of the interesting effects, which people even did not see in optics, that was we realized experimentally, was a change of transmission of a piece of metamaterial as a function of amplitude. So it's a slab of metamaterials which plays there, and we measure actually field behind the slab, and we make this piece of metamaterial tunable in the sense that we actually make nonlinear magnetic metamaterials. We make mu dependent on the incoming amplitude. So what happens when the amplitude is low, almost no transmission in here is detected, but when we increase the power of radiation of incoming network, incoming radiation from network analyzer, you see that suddenly that piece of metamaterials becomes transparent. The whole piece is opaque initially because epsilon here is positive and mu negative, so it's opaque. But when we increase power, mu becomes also negative, so we observe also positive, and that become we observe transmission. So this is even it's known from numerics, but it was never demonstrated in such a clear way in any field. That's how somehow we are proud of all these observations that became possible with metamaterials. Basically, opaque slab turns to be transparent by only changing the amplitude of incoming radiation. Of course, it was different approaches to study this effect of varactor diodes on nonlinear properties of metamaterials. This is an example of what we called nonlinear electric metamaterials, where we took the these meta atoms with electric response and put a varactor diode and saw how electric resonance can be tuned. Then it was many other activities from Kostas's group, who actually put interesting question to us about change of this resonance. Then many other groups, of course, approach this in different way. In from China, usually my Ilya Shadrivov usually complains that we are not getting enough credit from other groups around the world, but I keep telling him that our main achievement is a field, not nonlinear metamaterials, but the effect we actually produce on David to go to study nonlinearities, because he produced such a nice expansions in his talk that probably I should do it 10 years ago, but I did not. So David pushed that field much, much further, and I really like very much. People keep asking me about this relations between nonlinear optics and metamaterials, and I usually send them to this famous papers of David when he just exactly compared this response coming from optics and from metamaterials, in particular for this work when we measure it efficiency of four-wave mixing in metamaterials. This is important step, and I think many of the theories which we played with backward wave with metamaterials sooner or later will be realized in these structures with very interesting nonlinear response. Of course, you can play different games, and we did. Of course, we did try different things. So one of the idea was to use epsilon near zero channel, suggested by Naders in Geta group and Andrea Lu, and collaborated with them to make it nicely tunable. So you see that we now understand that this is a very efficient way to actually nonlinearly tune many of these microwave structures and devices. And even we came to idea of nonlinear tune or nonlinear activity, nonlinear chirality from interactions with Nikolai. And basically, we observed even in chiral response, we observed bistability, which is absolutely unusual thing. And of course, as usually Nikolai likes to exaggerate, he calculated that if you compare with normal crystals, so it's a 12 orders of difference enhancement in metamaterials. But problem is, of course, it's hard to compare. We don't know what to compare with. But it's indeed it's a dramatic enhancement of chirality. This is maybe another way to use nonlinear elements for control of metamaterials. More recently, we came with another idea, which also realized that microwaves, and this is already a strong collaboration with my St. Petersburg group. That group has now very good microwave facilities, and we do a lot of microwave experiments, but with optical facilities, it still should come. But this new concept was, can we create metamaterials, any type of metamaterials, which can be controlled by light? For example, David mentioned about QPM, quasi-phase matching, which is a very powerful tool to actually phase match different waves. But in nonlinear optics, we also know that we may impose some structures externally, for example, by electric field or by light, and actually control different type of nonlinear processes. So we added to Varactor diet, we added a light-sensitive device, which would allow to actually change overall capacitance in the structure and check this properties. So it's a bit ugly, but it's working. And then we can see that basically what happening here. We have a Varactor diet, or two Varactor diets, depends which mode we want to control, which has its own nonlinearity. This photosensitive element has its own nonlinearity. It's not linear. So we have a very interesting system. So in that system, we have, first of all, strong nonlinearity. And moreover, as we discovered recently, we may even make nonlinearity of different signs. So it will be competing nonlinearity. Competing nonlinearity, it was long-standing goal in nonlinear optics because people actually wanted to take advantage of different type of effects which may appear from competition. For example, one sign of nonlinearity at low intensities and other sign for high intensities, but it was never realized in the optics. At some stage, George Stegeman group reported that you can actually observe it, but then it was found that students made a mistake, student was fired, and basically nothing happens for that further developments. But here is a very simple system to see that competing nonlinearity. This is example of bistability, which can be also tuned because another source can be another way you can actually tune nonlinearity by light. But we also try to do something interesting like light control mirrors. The idea is very simple. We have a piece of metamaterials. Basically, metamaterials has composed of this photosensitive CRRs. And these photosensitive CRRs have resonances which control by external light. Now, basically, you send the light, and usually should be reflected at a specific angle. If you change properties of CRRs, we can actually tune the reflection of light depending on the conditions which we imposed by external source on this piece of metamaterial. That was realized in the waveguide geometry to show some of the experimental results, like phase change and the resonance change. So basically, it's all visible, dramatic effects you didn't expect it initially. And then we can even play, and just from the flat piece of metamaterial, we can create convex on concave reflectors, just only changing the external light source pattern. So basically, we believe that, and here we observed deviation by at least 13 degrees, so relatively strong effect. So we believe that that may give you some hint to explore these possibilities, because if you can have opportunity to pattern different structures and different properties on metamaterials from some light-emitting diodes, then it will give you completely different functionalities, for example, for antenna application, also tunability properties. Okay, I go to optical metamaterials. This is a tough path because I never had any experience in that, and it took many years, and now I understand why it's so difficult. It's much more difficult than microwaves, and actually Vlad sometimes complains, saying that, okay, in microwaves you can check everything very quickly, but in optics it takes a while. But fortunately, we got two former students of Martin Wegener. We hired two more people, so we have a big group which make fabrications, so we fabricated different type of structures. We can do a lot of different things, so this is standard fishnets metamaterials, magnetic metamaterials, similar to Wegener's with magnetic resonance. We can do different lattices of regular disordered lattices. This is what I will touch in my talk, but we have other things. So even it's hot, it's going on. But again, I would like to come back to my idea that we want to control both electric and magnetic properties. So for nonlinear electric metamaterials, or people call plasmonic metamaterials, people studied different type of controls. This comes from Nikolai's group, and this is from Anatoly Zayev's group. It's a nanorod metamaterial. But again, we control here only electric, nonlinear response of electric resonances. So it's much more important in metamaterials to control both electric and magnetic. In order to control magnetic properties, we look at fishnet metamaterials, which we establish like a very reliable object for different properties. And here we try to take advantage of this enhancement of fill-in holes. And but of course, problem again losses. So basically, if you look at the definition of nonlinearities, which nonlinearities we are looking for, this nonlinearity is very large. So in the usual conventional optics, that would be absolutely unrealistic numbers. Here, these nonlinearities can be achieved. Of course, optics is very different from microwaves, by infiltration, for example. That was one of the ideas we want to try. Infiltration with liquid crystals is a common technology people apply to plasmonic structures at different levels. And the idea is very simple. Then if you basically have a liquid crystal consists of elongated molecules, and then elongated molecules can be controlled by different means. One of them is to apply electric field. Then we can coherently rotate them in the different directions. And apparently, these materials with the different orientations of directors of this liquid crystal molecules have different refractive indices. This is what we can achieve easily in different systems. And people also work with photonic crystals by infiltrating photonic crystals with liquid crystals. Now, we try to infiltrate fishnets. So basically, we have standard fishnet structures fabricated from gold films on the glass. And we compare basically the cases when we don't have infiltration, we have infiltration. And of course, an experiment, very hard to know what's happening there, but so we need to be extra careful. We need to study the case when we actually assume that we don't infiltrate it well, so we create some pockets, but we assure you that we don't have that case. We have a full infiltration, so that's a medium curve corresponds this pocket case. So these are two curves which show experiment and theory, so we match very well, so we can study different effects based on these structures, and we assume that we can demonstrate many nonlinear effects with these structures, but it turns to be quite difficult. Nonlinear transmission, we study it also at different voltages, but what you see is that when increased power, we really observed a strong self-action effect. This is a transmission as a function of input power. This transmission can be tuned, by applying external voltage. So basically, this asymptotic shows that linear dependence. So we see the effects, but even we observe the self-action, even we observe it for the first time, it's still very hard to actually expect a strong nonlinear effect in this case. I would like to mention that it was several comments to our work that it's probably from heating, not from nonlinearity, but then we checked that basically if you compare what was observed by Vlad Shalaev's group, collaboration with WHO, that basically we look at the tuning through thermal effect, and this thermal effect obviously works in a different direction, so we can easily identify the difference and actually play ourselves with thermal effects as an effect which gives a different change of your transmission curves. More recently, we tried to play with magnetic metamaterials with a split and resonator and found very interesting effects that basically when we put a slab of liquid crystals on top of metamaterials, somehow there is a very, very strong anchoring effect of these molecules due to magnetic resonance in these split and resonators. This means that if you basically direct molecules to the opposite directions on the top layer, basically this in the slab, we will have a twisting molecules, and then transmission will be strongly affected by the orientation of these molecules. And in fact, we may achieve the switching between magnetic mode and electric mode of these metamaterials due to the slab which will change orientation of molecules. This is in real time movie, which should show you what's happening when we actually increase voltage. So this happens when we apply voltage. Suddenly we see that above some voltage, we change transmission. And this means that from this orientation of external magnetic field, we have this magnetic resonance first, and then we increase voltage. We somehow jump to electric resonance, and then transmission curve is changing. This is working still in progress, but means that we can control not only single resonance, magnetic or electric, but we can also organize a kind of switching between one resonance to another resonance of this metamaterial. Now we come to another work we recently did with emission control. We also plan to target this control of magnetic properties of metamaterials. And this is very active directions. People studied emission control in different settings. It was mentioned already many times. The latest work was control of emission of quantum dots deposited on the surface in so-called hyperbolic metamaterials when we have transitions from unbounded dispersion curves. This is curves from lifetime. So what we try to do in that directions, we try to actually, as I mentioned, to take advantage of magnetic resonances, and we design magnetic metamaterials to have resonances for wavelength which correspond to emission of our quantum dots. And in fact, our metamaterial has, depending on orientation of external field, has two different sharp resonances. One is electric resonance, and the second one is is magnetic magnetic resonance and electric resonance. So this is structure of the modes, and we both electric and magnetic modes are in wavelength of the emission of quantum dots. So we studied what happens if we will deposit quantum dots on top of the magnetic metamaterials and how quantum dots may couple to metamaterial. These are results which basically show that that the decay rate for to coupling to electric resonance and decay rate to magnetic resonance, excitation of electric or magnetic depends on polarization of external field, is completely different. So unlike the common belief that dipoles of the quantum dots should couple to electric resonance, we do not see much of coupling to electric resonance, but instead we see a relatively strong coupling to magnetic resonance. This is what we call the effect of intermode play in this this quantum dot emission, and we have some arguments why it's happening. But of course, enhancement is not dramatic; it's about three times. But mainly coupling going to magnetic modes of the splitting resonator. Another work we try to do for a number of years, we in the microwaves, we try to study effect of near-field interaction. So in metamaterials, we know that we applied usually concept of averaging, so we describe metamaterials by effective parameters. And somehow people do not discuss what is the symmetry of the lattice, so of this lattice of which composed metamaterials. But meta atoms may be arranged in different way if we follow the symmetry from crystalline lattice. Of course, we may find an interesting opportunity, so so-called quasi-crystalline symmetry. So quasi-crystals is a very active topic, especially after Shechtman got a Nobel Prize, and people became interested in more in these directions. But it's actually, I remember in 1984, it was a lot of discussions. Some people did not believe, in particular people educated on classics. But now it looks like a very trivial opportunity. Then we fabricated different type of structures, which composed of these meta atoms. And we put them in different order and try to understand what's happening. Of course, it's interesting story. I have a lot of behind that, but I just will mention about one of recent things. Of course, we may put them periodically. That's what usually people do in different type of crystallized geometry. Of course, now we are interested in quasi-periodic structures. We may arrange them quasi-periodically in a kind of Penrose-style structure. And of course, what else? We have disordered structures, but we did not pay in this particular project. We did not pay much to disorder. So, what is usual guess? Usual guess: we apply average theory and see what happens with our magnetic and electric resonances in that case. But we want to know how this will depend on type of symmetry. This is a diffraction patterns, which actually this is very similar to what Shechtman observed, and this is from disordered system. Now, for transmission, of course, it's not a big surprise. Regular system has a much stronger resonances, much stronger response, and it's obvious. Of course, we can play with different symmetries, but still the effect will be strong. This is the strongest periodic system if we are in the regime average or effective parameters. Of course, if you put it in disordered way, we still see very clear features, very clear resonances in transmission. But of course, because of interaction, they are not that sharp. But quasi-periodicity somehow plays in between. So that's somehow not surprising, because we know that from other field, that somehow it's a short and long order. Here we break short and long order, and here because we break only long order, then we may see some similar features like we have for regular system. However, question is what would be different? And then to see the difference, we actually look at chirality. We know that chirality was already discussed here, so chirality is very interesting property, in particular for metamaterials, because it can bring new special features by coupling electric and magnetic field. But generally, chirality is discussed as a chirality of separate elements. So if a non-chiral, basically the structure will be composed of non-chiral element, will be non-chiral. The other type of chirality, it's actually attributed to a number of people who understand it very well, including Nikolai Zholodev. It's all extrinsic chirality. So if you take a symmetric element and then tilt your sample, in tilting sample, you will tilt your element as well. So element of metamolecule become chiral. We call it extrinsic chirality because we introduce asymmetry through tilting. But here what we observe, so-called extrinsic chirality for lattices, because each element is absolutely symmetric. But for lattices, it makes a big difference. These are our results, which show actually this resonances, transmission, as a function of different angles for different wavelengths. It's a bit difficult to read, but it's a very simple way to present it. So basically, on top, we have similar curves like that. So it's transmission. So you see that two resonances, magnetic and electric, very, very well pronounced. This is for regular systems. This is for quasi-periodic. This is for disordered. There's basically no surprise. We break order. We introduce interactions, we break coherence, and then we come to low resonance response. But look at the lower curve. Here, what we measure it circular dichroism. And surprisingly, is that we observed very strong circular dichroism when, of course, we are not 45, but here and there, when the system is periodic, but almost no effect for quasi-periodic. So we have a very little change to periodicity, just from periodic to quasi-periodic, completely kill the dichroism. In that way, we introduce kind of isotropy in our system. So this quasi-periodic metamaterials, we have a great advantage that basically resonant effect is almost strong as in for regular lattices, but other properties change completely. So basically resemble here response of disordered system. This is still in progress. Just wanted to show different type of activities we have in this metamaterial business. And you see, still you can find many interesting problems. And I move to another part of my talk, which involves now dielectric and hybrid structures. Of course, when people discuss plasmonics, we usually show this cartoon, which shows how charges are separated and how dipole moment is created. And this is well-known effect. It's an non-linear response of metal particle, or response of metal particles. But this is a less common cartoon which shows how actually we create magnetic response, but it's also well-known. But I'd like to mention that similar to metal nanoparticles, we can do it with dielectric nanoparticles. And again, John was here, one of the first who actually mentioned magnetic moment of dielectric structures. And it's kind of ongoing activity. And why it's ongoing? Because it was hard to move to optics. You see that, of course, this all dielectric response was studied for microwaves. But the issue is that basically having dielectric particles, we can actually have a magnetic moment, which is the lowest resonance in the Mi theory. For example, this is a scattering efficiency of high dielectric particles like like silica, and then you see that this first resonance is actually magnetic dipole. And I think things changed very recently when two groups independently measured magnetic response at visible. So this is a group of Boris Chichkov in Germany and group of Boris Lukianchuk in Singapore. So I think it will change our attitude to all the electric structures. And I will show you a few examples why it's interesting, why we think that might be a new wave of development of this concept of metamaterials for further applications. I'd like to mention that it was already many efforts to create a kind of metamaterials. This is from Igal Brennel group from Sandia, when we created at mid-infrared the structure which is all dielectric and measure it magnetic response of the structure. But of course, we need to realize what is the link to this of these structures to photonic crystals. It's a different issue. However, if you have dielectric particles and metal particles, and we look for magnetic moment generated by these two objects, it turns out that magnetic moment is different. So magnetic dipoles of the electric particles and magnetic and metal particle completely different. So we look at the simplest problem. We took a single dielectric sphere and a split and resonator and try to study what happens with their magnetic moment, which we may move them closer to each other. So what we discovered that if you look at the ground state of the system, when we move them close enough, basically magnetic moments becomes interact strongly and we have different nature. And one of the equilibrium states in the system, it states what we call anti-ferromagnetic state. So basically due to coupling between magnetic moments of sphere and split and resonator, we have a state when we flip. So basically this is a equilibrium state of this pair interacting. So basically spins directly opposite. So in that sense, we have a kind of interesting situation when we can map the theory of magnetic systems, which are not optically induced magnetism, so a magnetism completely different origin, to the systems which composed of different elements where kind of spin-spin interactions becomes very strong. So in particular, this is strong interactions leads to stable arrangement in the form of anti-ferromagnetic response. This is examples which show the directions of field. Another way to explore core shell nanoparticles, because if you have usual dielectric nanoparticles, we can play with dielectric moment and see that in a general sense we have a symmetric radiation pattern. But if you create a core shell nanoparticles, so we can introduce magnetic moment in addition to dipole moment of metal nanoparticles, and we can actually play with electric and magnetic dipoles to observe different effects. One of the effects is create a completely unidirectional emission pattern through interactions between magnetic and electric dipole for full compensations, for example, radiation in that direction. That's interesting opportunity and also can be employed for construction of different type of metamaterials. One of the interesting effects which we have with core shell particles is so-called polarization-independent Fano resonance. Because usually Fano resonance is polarization-dependent because we have specific selected directions of dipole moment which interact with periodic system. And if you rotate radiation patterns, the Fano effect is sharp peak disappears. But if you involve core shell nanoparticles, there's two dipole and magnetic momentum may support Fano resonance for any polarization. That's an interesting observation, which we recently published. Because I mentioned Fano, I like to mention about Fano effects in more details, because that was kind of my toy for many years. And Fano resonance it's a very powerful concept. I should say I'm really surprised, even working in this field for many years, that Fano resonance appears everywhere. So we come just every day, you come new Fano resonance. But Fano itself, it's actually a student of Fermi, as you probably know. It's an interesting personality. I I got the chance to talk to two postdocs of FANO. It's Charles Clark from NIST and Shin Watanabe, who moved from US to Japan. And they told me many interesting stories. In particular, they told me an interesting story, which of course we can't verify, that the idea of FANO effect was suggested to FANO by Fermi in 35. And basically, he did calculations but never showed it to FANO and ask his student to actually complete it. It's amazing things, but it's a very powerful concept which appears everywhere. And the simply original idea is relatively simple. So we have a state with a very broad spectrum, and we have state with a very narrow spectrum, and we interact somehow in a quantum mechanic level. This discrete eigenstates enters continuum eigenstates, and we see some in response. We see some kind of asymmetric shape. This is described by famous FANO formula, which can be derived for simplified models, but this is how it was written. But funny thing is that originally results were published in Nuovo Cimento, and we were published much earlier. I mean, I don't remember exactly, I don't have reference. But then we were republished in 61, and I asked Shin Watanabe, his postdoc, why FANO published his paper in PhysRev after so many years? First of all, it was already war, finished and whatever, and he said, oh, FANO learned about delta function. This delta function, this formalism was much nicer, you know, because original formalism was quite complicated. Anyway, I have few examples to show you that FANO is everywhere. First of all, FANO is in Mi formulas. That's what for me it was a real surprise, because you know, Mi formulas were derived in 1908, and we celebrated recently 100 years of this Mi formulas. But so basically, Mi formulas describe how a plane wave scatters by particles, whatever the electric, magnetic, whatever, and if you look carefully what's happening, then this you go exactly to FANO formulas, to exact FANO formulas, you will discover so-called anomalous scattering. Anomalous scattering is a regime when basically particle excite its local mode. So basically what's happening, there is radiation which come in, and they interact with particle which has a kind of resonance. So it's easy to satisfy with a metal particle. So we basically have a narrow resonance and broad resonance, and we have very similar conditions. When we got that idea, we tried to look at exact formulas, and then Mikhail Tribelsky, who is very good in all this analytics, it's not trivial exercise, he actually shown that we can take exact Mi formulas from, I hope from 1908, but obviously we were written, and derive from these formulas FANO formula for specific condition. So basically that's very similar to what we describe in physics. Very recently, we managed to explain what was observed in a long-standing experiment by a group of Misha Limonov in Yoffe. Basically, the FANO effect and FANO formulas in disordered systems. This sounds like counterintuitive, but in fact, we do have regimes when we can see for relatively strong disorders the interactions of Bragg modes with a broader disordered states and the kind of FANO shape. It's a very long story to explain this, so I move to show you that we publish almost simultaneously with the famous review on plasmonic FANO resonances. We publish review on FANO resonance in everywhere in different fields, including Bose-Einstein condensate, even try to explain this famous Kondo effect somehow related to FANO resonance. So it's a lot of interesting things in this review, but I would like to attract your attention that we don't need actually continuous spectrum. And it's already known in the community we study FANO effects that we need just two resonances. We need two resonances, as many people understand, low Q and high Q, bad and good resonance, and already in that simple settings you will see FANO shape. This is a FANO shape which is observed in response of this first driven oscillator. And of course, I always thought that this is a toy model. So in the toy model, you just assume that it's so simple, but in reality it's so complicated because you need to go to something like complicated mean formulas to try to dig out specific conditions. But recently we came to very simple models. This is the simplest ever. So what we have? We have a high dielectric sphere, and of course dipole is a source. As I mentioned, there is special interest to these high dielectric spheres because they are antennas, so people study different effects associated with nano-antennas, but now with dielectric spheres because we assume that we can generate magnetic response and actually get all effects which we usually have from metal nanoparticles through electric effects. So now what we have, if you excite resonance here, we observed exactly Fano effect. So what is shown here, this is radiation pattern of silicon nanoparticle excited from this dipole source depending on wavelength. So if you draw some curve, this is curve which represent radiation coming along that direction. And you see that this is typical Fano curve. So basically, if you look at the movie, as soon as we change wavelength, you see that radiation pattern of this single particle changes and it passes Fano curves, which allows you to move from complete suppression of radiation in that direction and enhance radiation in that direction. So basically, one single dielectric nanoparticles where we excite magnetic moment may already show you very interesting effects. Of course, the idea is to take these nanoparticles, look at this, what did people did in plasmonics, and compare what people play with plasmonical nanoparticles and with dielectric nanoparticles. The simple, of course, geometry are probably one nanoparticles because it may have already unidirectionality, but we may take also Yagi-Uda configuration. So it's basically several nanoparticles, which one is a larger one and place source there. So it's a Yagi-Uda dielectric nanoantenna. So question is, what is the effect of this magnetic dipole? We may compare radiation efficiency, and then somehow when you get it, you see it, that it's quite simple. So of course, if you put particles a bit far away from each other, you see that basically performance, it's I think 90 nanometers apart. Oh, I can check it here. 90 nanometers apart. So basically, we have the same radiation efficiency for dielectric and for metal nanoparticles. However, when we put them closer, almost nothing changes for dielectric nanoparticles, but there is a dramatic change for metal nanoparticles because field become localized in between. It's a distance 20 nanometers. So basically, so we have a dramatic decrease of radiation efficiency, meaning that we can place dielectric particles closer and get a better nanoantenna effect than with metallic nanoparticles. Then we can continue this game and compare different type of plasmonic and all dielectric structures. One of the things we are doing now is to compare, for example, these oligomers, which people like Harald Gissen, Naomi Peter all like them and play with the resonances. But that we see that, of course, we have this famous resonance between the central nanoparticles and these six surrounding nanoparticles. This is two modes, and the interference between these two modes give you a very sharp feature of Fano resonance. The only difference is that for dielectric nanoparticles, this is the very very sharp feature which survives when you change the distance. For plasmonic nanoparticles, something different happening, and this deep is not exactly that deep. So what I claim here is that initial explanation that deep is actually produced by interference by these two modes, it's not entirely correct, unfortunately. So because again, as coming back to my first statement, in plasmonic, very strong losses. So if you reduce losses in metal particles artificially, just put by hand, and reduce losses, you will see that picture, and it will be different resonance. Anyway, there are many interesting opportunities with this dielectric nanoparticles, but I come to last part of my talk, because we are doing this nanoplasmonics and metamaterials in frame of CUDAS. We talk about signal processing and applications. The idea was to make some functional structures. And one of the opportunities is to make so-called metamaterial circuitry. For that, we need to actually place all our magnetic resonances on waveguides. This is the first ideas, which we actually create structures from photoresist by usual laser writing, then put the metallic parts on that. This is actually procedure, which is cartoon by Isabel, former postdoc of Wegener, as I mentioned. And these are some of the fabricated structures. You see, we can put a splitter resonator in different sequences on a waveguide structure and write different functional structures, I think, is the first step. And what we try to do, we measure it magnetic resonance in this structure. This is vertically stained splitter resonators. And you see there is a good agreement between numerics and experiments. So I believe that we can think of kind of waveguides, as what we sometimes my students call it 2 plus 1, 2 plus half dimension, but it's actually 3 dimensions. So create structures and put all our magnetic features on a waveguide and actually study how interaction of guided modes, because we need to guide it somewhere, and it's not an open space transmission, and then get advantage of magnetic resonances. Now I will move to very briefly mention what's happening in St. Petersburg, Canberra, which has a project, and we'll finally come to the end. So in Canberra, we have different activities from different sites. So we try to develop concept of nonlinear antennas. So far, theoretically, we look at different type of antennas as well, and also experimentally and theoretically. There is a very strong interest to so-called hyperbolic metamaterials. And we got an idea that if you look at the dispersion of so-called fishnet, but multi-layered fishnet, we can get so-called magnetic hyperbolic media. This is really much richer than just simple dielectric metal structures. If you look at holes, so fishnet structures, so we basically can modify both electric and magnetic, exactly as was described in PRL, David and Shurik, I guess. And so we can actually control both epsilon and mu, making both component epsilon and mu negative and positive in that structure. So a very rich system. Of course, it's hyperbolic only somewhere here. It's much more complicated. In St. Petersburg, I mentioned we have a good microwave facility. So we run different microwave projects. So this is verifications of all dielectric antennas. This unidirectionality was checked. For microwaves, it's quite easy experiment with very high dielectric spheres here. We look at the kind of spiral structures, very interesting features, because spirals like small circuits, but they can be very flexible. We can change size. So basically, we may introduce magnetoelasticity here and observe strong nonlinear response. With transmission lines, there is some historical activity there, but it's also interesting type of activities. We can also engineer response. On the theoretical part, we look at different manifestation of parcel effect, and I believe it's interesting observations that we can actually engineer parcel effect for multi-photon scattering. And more recently, we looked theoretically at the control of clocking by nonlinearity. And finally, I come to the conclusion and will briefly mention topic I discuss. I mentioned about shaping of plasmonic beams through the idea of fiery resonances, discuss a bit of nonlinearities, how to make nonlinearities working in plasmonics, and mention this oscillons. I think it's interesting opportunity for experimental observation. Then I basically mention about metamaterials, some of our work which we are doing. And obviously, this field is very active, many new ideas coming, and I think it requires more efforts to make something workable. And finally, I mentioned that maybe it's a new road for all dielectric and particular metal dielectric structures, which we observed not only new physics, but also and new effects. Thanks for your attention. I think I was good this time, right?
Very well timed.
Thank you.
Okay, we have time for questions. Okay.
First. When you did the quantum dots with the splittering resonators, and you did the photoluminescence, could you do pump probe experiments?
In principle, yes, but we did not do it yet here.
Yeah, I mean, we have done a lot of simulations. We can talk a little bit
good.
More. Yeah. Now, what is the all dielectric and plasmonic nanophotonics, what they have done with the dielectric silicon, what is at optics wavelength, the dielectric function, it is...
No, it's visible, of course, yeah, yes. Yeah, so what we did, we just created the spheres, and measured their response and identify responses and found that the highest response, highest maximum comes from magnetic dipoles. That was, of course, we see electric dipoles and magnetic dipoles, see different colors that you didn't see in any of these papers. Yeah, it's very fresh. Yeah.
Yeah. And how much is the diameter of silicon?
40, 50 nanometers, something like that. Yeah. It's a wavelength, it's very, very connected. As I show you diagram, it's actually taken from. Actually, initially it was joint paper, Lukianchuk and Chichkov, and then somehow we published separately. That was taken from their paper. There is a very, very strong connection between the wavelength of resonance, magnetic dipole resonance, and the size of the particles. Of course, for visible, it should be small particle. Yeah.
Can you really make a negative index of material?
That's what we want to do. Yeah, particularly I know that Chichkov is trying to do it, by different means. But we collaborate with Lukianchuk group because it's close in Singapore, very close. and what we try to do now, we try to actually measure interaction of magnetic dipoles from the spheres with quantum dots and also see that unidirectional radiation of a single nanospheres, which already preliminary was observed, and this kind of effect.
Okay, many wonderful, fascinating results and phenomena. Thank you. One thing that I would like to raise a question on was this: when you talked about the chirality, so this distinction between the intrinsic chirality, where the inclusion itself is different from mirror image and external, where the external constellation takes place also. So the interesting result was that for the regular case, you found out that there is circular dichroism.
Whereas very strong dichroism. If you look at oblique waves,
Oblique waves. How about optical rotation? Only dichroism, but so that means
we
that
didn't measure that.
Okay.
So this extrinsic and intrinsic, that was I think introduced by only a few groups, and one of them it's Nikolai's group, which made measurements for their symmetric plasmonic resonances. But as you see, that we observed the similar things, not for single elements, because elements are absolutely symmetric, but for the whole lattice.
But for this. What is called extrinsic chirality, then it requires that in the plane the elements have to be like two-dimensionally chiral. I mean, like split rings, for example. A bar would not make it.
I don't know.
Okay. Yes.
I don't know. That's something what relatively fresh for me. Yeah.
I just want to say a couple of things again about an old subject, which is the question of magnetism at high frequencies. I mean, we should not be surprised that an object exhibits magnetic activity if the size of that object is comparable to the wavelength. What is very hard is to get magnetic activity when the size of the object is very small compared with the wavelength. And with diamagnets, as all these are dielectrics, there are only two ways to do that. Either the penetration depth of the light is very small compared with the size of the particle, That's one way to get...
But we need displacement currents, right?
Well, but the currents, the magnetic diamagnetism is extraordinarily weak. So you will never get a resonance out of a diamag. So the only way to do that, and that's what a split ring resonator does, is has currents in at the surface that behave ultimately, if you wish, like a spin. But these currents are huge because they need to shield the outside field inside. So the other way to do this, and it would be like a paramagnet, is to have very high refractive index.
Yep.
So these two things and the condition that the metamaterial be an effective medium cannot be met at indivisible. It's impossible to get, we will be doing, you can push it to maybe 2-3 microns, but at shorter wavelengths, you cannot meet these conditions. So the magnetic activity is not going to happen at these high frequencies.
Thanks for your comment, but people understand that near-field interaction is very important. So this all this effective parameters, of course, it's
near-field. Near-field or far-field is not going to happen. I was reacting you were making a point about some results on magnetic dipole activity in the visible. But look, the size of the particle is comparable to lambda. So that's not a surprise. It was about 500 nanometers, right? So magnetic effects are K times A square, right? 2 pi A over lambda square. Yeah, those results. So the size of the particle is pretty large.
No, that's very small.
Well, I don't... Yeah, that's what I was reacting. Yeah. And then you have the 2 pi, of course.
What's the epsilon?
You mean epsilon of what?
You have also epsilon.
Yeah, that's a small effect. In the visible, you know, it's 2-3. But it's not very large. 2-3.
Ah, this is a radius of particles, yeah.
What is it?
Silicon particle, yeah. And this
well,
is
you have a 2 pi, right? Let's not forget 2 pi.
Resonance. For silicon, yes. 11, 12, yeah.
Well, that helps a little, indeed.
So that's 3 times 2 pi times R.
Yeah, like I said, I mean, you can get to 1 micron, 2 microns, but that's pushing it, right? I mean, that's all.
So... thank you for your nice talk. So I have one question about the phosphorescence in the narrow shell ray. So in that case, so there's no coupling between the narrow shell. So just the phosphorescence comes from the interference.
Yeah, but phosphoresonance is interference effect, yeah.
Oh, yes. So yeah. In my understanding, so the phosphorescence is come from interference between the magnetic resonance of a single narrow shell and the Braga interference, Braga resonance of the array.
Yeah, that's true, yeah. But you compose them in a, yeah, that's true, because okay. It's fun resonance in that array. So. It's an interference between the broad mode and one single mode of single particle, yeah.
So for the Braga resonance, so the peak should be narrower than the magnetic resonance, so you can have a fun resonance.
Yeah, but if you have a fixed dipole, basically this fun resonance will be polarization dependent.
Yes. In my understanding, so if you tune the angle, the incident angle, so you can tune the Prager resonance frequency.
You
so
can.
So the incident angle. So if you change the incident angle, you can tune
and you,
the.
Fun resonance will disappear if you have only one dipole. Yeah.
Yes, but in my understanding, so the fun resonance peak can be changed. Through change the incident angle?
Not really, unless you have a kind of double dipole interaction. Yeah, two dipoles, magnetic and electric.
Yes.
We may talk about that later. Yeah.
Okay, thank you.
Yes, I want to make a follow-up comment on what was said about the dielectric sphere and the magnetic phenomena that we observe. After all, at resonance, we have a balance of electrical and magnetic energy. And if we go past that, even though it's dielectric, you know, we could still have the magnetic phenomenon, not needing to have something like the split ring only, which can, of course, produce that at a lower frequency. So I think what was said about the necessity of having resonance, and then we have this, is agreed upon. But I couldn't understand the comment that, well, effective medium theory would not work because the size of the particle is now not small compared to wavelength. So are we, if we look for a magnetic phenomena, we observe it, I don't see that it makes any difference whether the effective medium theory would or would not work for that.
Yeah, but we know that even for photonic crystals, we have backward waves, you know. It depends what you actually, what you're after. If you need really effective medium or you just need negative refraction. Negative refraction you may get even photonic crystals.
That's exactly right.
Yeah, yeah, thank you.
I think that's a very interesting discussion, whether this high epsilon is possible to produce, to drive these magnetic mirror resonances. And Roberto, I think it's a very strong statement to say something is not going to happen. It's impossible.
It's too strong,
for,
I think.
For instance, I think, I think it's,
we don't agree.
I think it's an interesting discussion, and I think there is this route towards high epsilon materials, which is to basically combine metals closely spaced, say, metal nanoparticles. And for that, you can have, say, a material like aluminum that already in the visible behaves like a good metal, like very high epsilon, very negative. And then when put very close together at short distances, much shorter than the size of the particles, then that behaves as an effective high epsilon material. Now, maybe that this might be very challenging. You see, you might want to have a spacings of 1 nanometer and particles of 10 nanometers to get an effective material at working at operating at a few hundred nanometer wavelength. It's challenging, but maybe that's the challenge. Or even finding other materials other than silicon or germanium that can increase the epsilon.
Okay, but we can continue later because there is lunch
at
coming
least it
up.
Pushes
so
us
I'm gonna
to
make
think
it
about
very,
something,
very short.
Something
I'm gonna make it very short. I mean, it's not fair in a discussion to bring people who have work who are of the caliber of Landau and Lipschitz. But I got interested in this issue because if you look at, and most people here have done that, Landau makes a very strong point that the permeability has to be set equal to 1. Almost above terahertz. So I looked into that, and I wrote a long paper on that. And the reason, the only way to get out of that point is what I said before. Either you have a dielectric with a very large permittivity, but in the visible, the largest permittivity is, what, 10, right? You're not going to find a material. Put metals aside. Now, metals, on the other hand, are going to give you extraordinary diamagnetism, as an LC resonator does at low frequencies, it has an extraordinary effect. And this is the piece that Landau missed, if you want to insist. And it's only because the penetration depth is very small compared with the size. And this creates, look, it's fantastic. You look at the magnetic polarizability of the sphere. So if the permittivity is 10, 20, 30, it's a Ka square effect. It's not very important. But if the penetration depth becomes small compared with the radius of the sphere, you get 1. So at that point, the magnetic permeability and the permittivity are of the same order. And this is ultimately the reason why everything is possible, right, in LC resonators and all that.
We have to talk later because it's not individual spheres. It's when
but
you
I'm
put
glad
the spheres
that you,
close together.
You started that discussion because it's very important. People looking for a future, you know, and that's a very important comment. Thank you.
Right. I think we probably should wrap this up, and let's thank the speaker first.